what you picture that you gave to me. And it's signed with love, just like it used to be. The only thing different, the only thing new, I've got your picture, she's got you. I've got the records that we used to share, and they still sound the same as when you were here. The only thing different, the only thing new, I've got the records, she's got you.
Born way back on September 8th, 1932. Her name is what? Does anybody know her real name? I'll let you think about it. I'll tell you her real name next time. Patsy Cline is, actually, Patsy was a nickname her mother gave her. She was born in Winchester, Virginia. Small town, well, fairly decent-sized town in Virginia. And at a very, very young age, she demonstrated the fact that she wanted to be an entertainer, wanted to be on stage. At 4 years old, she taught herself how to dance. And she entered in contests around Winchester and Lexington, even won one or two, I understand. But then, at a very young age of 8 years old, she ended up with a very serious throat infection that put her in a hospital for about 8 or 10 days. Back then, they put her in that big oxygen tent they used to have back in those early years. And then finally, they sent her home to recover. Now, when she recovered, they say that one day she found out that, wow, I got a voice. I mean, a voice that boomed out of her, much like Kate Smith at that time. So, I don't have to tell you, wanting to entertain wasn't going to be dancing anymore, it was going to be singing. And this girl sang
everywhere she could.
At the very young age of 10 years old, she was singing in choirs with her mom at church socials and school events and things of that nature. But as she progressed into her teen years, she started to hook up with different country bands. Country was her real choice for music. And she played at bars and school dances and honky-tonks into her teen years. One of the things she used to love to do, though, she used to love to listen to the radio. And the radio station that she listened to all the time was right here, WSM. And the reason she listened to WSM, guess why? The Grand Ole Opry. That was the station it was broadcast on. And think of the greats that she listened to back then. Bill Monroe, Eddie Arnold, Roy Acuff, Hank Williams, Kitty Wells. Could you have been influenced by any better musicians and singers if you were in a country field? I mean, these were the greats. These were the real greats. Well, word got out real fast about her vocals, about how good she was, and what a great entertainer. Then in 1954, she was invited by a company called All Star Records to come in and meet with them. They offered her a contract to sign, and they signed her to produce 16 tracks for them over the next 4 years. Well, she was producing tracks for them. And then finally, in 1957, January 21st, to be exact, it was a Monday evening, she talked her mom, Hilda Patterson, into sponsoring her as a girlfriend, not as a mother, but as a girlfriend, on the Arthur Godfrey Talent Scout Hour. Do you guys remember that show? Remember there was that big screen up there like this? It had a big applause meter on it. And as you performed, at the end of your performance, whether you sang, whether you danced, you could have trained dogs, you could have been a clown, they didn't care, but you had your 3 minutes, and that meter would register the applause, and whoever registered the highest was brought back that following week. Well, Patsy went there that Monday with her mother. They showed up, and Patsy met her first program and talent coordinator. Her name was Jeanette Davis. She walked into the studio, and Jeanette says, "Hiya, Patsy, how are you? What are you going to sing for us tonight?" So Patsy presented a song called Poor Man's Roses, Rich Man's Gold. Jeanette listened to it and said, "Patsy, I don't know about this. This is kind of slow, kind of draggy ballad. Don't you have something else?" So they looked through Patsy's collection of records and they found one. And Jeanette says, "Now that's the song I'd like to see you sing. It's bluesy, it's up-tempo. This is the thing that's going to sound good on national TV." So here we go. I'm going to take you back there right now to that evening. It was a Monday evening, as I said, January 21st, 1957. You were probably sitting in your living room watching your old black and white Sylvania TV. And what you would have seen was Arthur Godfrey sitting at his podium with Hilda next to him, And he would have said something like, "Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the show this evening. We have some great talent here tonight." But our very first guest up tonight is a young lady that comes to us from Winchester, Virginia, and she's going to sing for us. So why don't you put your hands together and please welcome Miss Patsy Cline.
I go out walking after midnight, out in the moonlight, just like we used to do. Always walking after midnight, searching for you. I'll open my eyes on the highway, but that's just my way.
Patsy appeared on the Godfrey Show, the song Walking After Midnight climbed right up to the country charts to the number one position. But it did something else that year that many songs didn't do. It did what we call in the music industry a crossover. And what that simply means is that it went from the country charts over to the pop charts. And it ended up that year number three on the pop charts, right behind, guess who? Elvis Presley in the number one and two position. Wow, if you're going to be number three, but where else behind the king, huh? Well, something else happened to Patsy. The phone rang. And the phone call went something like this. "Hi, Patsy, my name is Little Jimmy Dickens, and I'm here calling you from Nashville, Tennessee. Well, we have a show down here called the Grand Ole Opry, I'm sure you've heard of, and we heard you just had a big number one hit, and we'd like you to come down and join us." Well, Patsy, after all those years of listening to those greats, she packed up and went right on down there. So what we're going to do right now is I'm going to take you here from the Westchester Theater, and I'm going to take you there to that very first night that Patsy performed on stage at the Grand Ole Opry. And I'm going to give you my interpretation of the way I think it went. "Well, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Little Jimmy Dickens. How y'all doing out there? All righty. Well, we're broadcasting tonight from coast to coast with 50,000 watts of AM power. And boy, do we have a show for you tonight. We have a lot of top guests on board with us, but right now we have a very special lady that comes to us from Winchester, Virginia. Just had a big hit with a song called Walking After Midnight. But tonight she's going to sing a very special song for you. So, Patsy, how do you feel about singing tonight?"
"I feel fine."
"Well, you're looking good, girl, too."
"Well, thank you."
That Virginia water must be treating you real good up there.
Yes,
well, I'll tell you, she's going to sing a song for you that Kitty Wells just made popular about 3 months ago. And the name of that song is It Wasn't God That Made Honky Tonk Angel. Patsy?
That tune about the wild side.
Patsy Cline once again. Well, you know, she arrived here at the Grand Ole Opry early today, and I had a chance to go backstage and meet with her a while. We had a long talk, and we talked about where I came from and where she came from. She found out something for me. She found out I come from a little town in Texas, and she has a little song she says she was going to sing for me. And you know, every time I hear this song, it brings a little tear to my eye because it makes me think of home. Patsy, you going to sing that song for me right now?
I'm going to do this one just for you, little Jimmy Dickens.
That's my girl. Ladies and gentlemen, Patsy Cline once again with San Antonio Rose.
Deep within my heart lies a melody, a song of old San Antonio, where in dream I live with a memory, beneath the stars all alone. Well, it was there I found, beside the animal, enchanting, strange as the blue of a bar.
You know, Patsy appeared many, many times at the Grand Ole Opry between 1957 and 1960. Now, I can stand up here and take you through song by song, but we're not going to do that right now. We're going to turn this over to Patsy, and we're going to let her take you on a wonderful, beautiful musical memory tour of those Grand Ole Opry years. So, Patsy, it's all yours.
Well, thank you. How about that little Jimmy Dickens? Let me do a good job. Thank you, little Jimmy Dickens. Thank you so much. How y'all doing out there tonight? Y'all having a good time? Okay. Well, right now I'm going to give you a little Kentucky with a little Blue Moon of Kentucky. Shine on the one that's gone and left me blue. so much. All right, ladies and gentlemen, my next song was written by Mr. Hank Williams. And he made it a number one hit. And I just hope I can make it a number one hit with you all here tonight. But before I do, I have to dedicate this one to all you men out there. And this one is called Your Cheating Heart. Too. All right, this next song goes out to all you risk takers. Yep, you Atlantic City runners, you Tuesday and Friday night card gamblers. But most of all you stock market fools. That's right. We're gonna do a little one called Turn the Cards Slowly. Deal it.
Rambling, gambling, reckless way you treat my heart to see.
and gentlemen, time to do a little mathematics here. How much money do you think Patsy made on Walking After Midnight? I'm going to give you some hints, and let's see if we can figure it out. First of all, the record sold 750,000 copies. Back then, in 1957, if a record sold 25,000 copies on a country label, it went right to number one. This record sold 750,000 copies. Now, according to Patsy's contract with Four Star Records, she was entitled to 2.34% of every record she sold. Now, 2.34% of 85 cents, because that's what records sold for back then, comes to approximately, and you multiply that times 750,000, comes to approximately $15,000. All right? Some money for a night's work, huh? But it wasn't meant to be. Her contract with Four Star Records had a lot of loopholes in it, and the loopholes went like this. Patsy had to pay for these guys back here, had to pay for their transportation, their costumes, their music, recording sessions, advertising, distribution, publication, her own phone bills, her own food, her own transportations. When all was said and done, now how much money do you think Patsy made? She didn't do too bad. Considering the average American back in 1957 made between, I think it was $2,000 and $3,000, she'd made $900 on that cut. $900, a half a year's salary and 3 hours in a studio? Ain't too bad, I guess, huh? Well, and besides that, back then, artists were more concerned with selling records for not making their money off the record, but the more records they sold, the more money they can demand for personal appearances. So it really was a good shot for Patsy. Well, right about that time, it's 1960 now, Patsy's contract with Four Star Records runs out. And everybody assumed that because she had this big hit, she was going to sign again with Four Star. But nope, she doesn't do that. She surprises everybody. What she does, she signs with a small company out there called Decca Records. All right? When she signs with Decca, a couple of things happen. The first, the most important thing, is that she gets to continue working with the famous Owen Bradley. Now, Owen Bradley has produced some of the greatest. I mean, Kitty Wells, Connie Francis, Brenda Lee, Bobby Helms, it goes on and on and on. And she gets a whole library of new music. And when I say library of new music, what I mean is this. Back then, when you worked for a label, the label gave you the music you were going to record. You didn't pick it. So Decca had a whole library that she was awarded and able to record. Well, Owen and Patsy got together at this point, and they said, all right, Owen, we had a hit with Walking After Midnight, but we haven't been doing well since then, all lukewarm hits. What are we going to do? Owen talks Patsy into doing away with this country up-tempo stuff that she likes. It's time to get you into the rock, pop, and blues. We got to try this. And Owen's idea is this. We're going to get rid of this steel guitar player back here. He's gone. We paid too much money for him anyway. And we're going to bring a couple of background groups in. The first group they bring in is the Anita Kerr Singers. Do you remember them? All right, that's the first group that goes behind her. The second group that backs her up is another little unknown group of males, the Jordanaires. They back her up. Well, this next set that you're about to hear, I like to call Patsy's transition set, because this is where she transitions out of the country and into the blues, pop, and rock and roll. So once again, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome back our Patsy Cline.